Thanks everybody for coming in this evening. It's a pleasure to welcome Antón García-Abril and Débora Mesa from Ensamble Studio for a presentation of their recent work, which will focus in tonight's presentation particularly on their astonishing landscape structures, which are incredibly unique and is conventionally described incredibly unique site-specific installations. And to call these particular projects, I think, site-specific doesn't go nearly far enough. Because with Antón and Débora, when they work with the site, they will often take the site itself, not just as a place, but as either the material or the basis for forming those things that we think of as the architectures that come out of it. In fact, it's a phenomenal combination of art, nature, and architecture, all done really as three different parts of one larger project, where the boundaries between those categories aren't just challenged, but almost completely dissolve in their hands and in these projects. For the past few years, Antón, I think many of you know, has been a visitor here every summer, and we hope to see him again in that role as an external examiner in the undergraduate school. The Madrid-based studio ensemble includes now a studio in the United States in the Northeast, where Antón teaches at MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and their studio is a paradigmatic contemporary example of a platform that is at once an office, a research agenda, and basically just an open-ended field of experimentation like few other offices in the world today. Many of you had a chance, I think, to see a wonderful exhibition that was included as a part of this last summer's Venice Architecture Biennale, in which videotapes showed over and over in loops remarkable Jurassic-scaled objects that look sometimes like architecture and sometimes like the Montana landscape that they're carved out of. Everybody, please join me in welcoming Antón and Débora.
Thank you very much. Happy to be back home. This time, not judging your work, but letting you judge our work. It's a better position, I would say. And I was telling Red that for the first time, we are going to center our work in explaining one single project, but trying to extend, and this was a self, I would say like a mirror, no? Try to explain and extend the reasons and the emotions that drove us here through all our career. So we're going to explain you the origins of our vision about landscape, our interpretations, how we arrived to this blurry, slippery, ambiguous condition between architecture, landscape, engineering.
Yes, sometimes we develop projects and also having to communicate them to express how we have thought about them and how we develop is also an act of really realizing some of the connections between our works and between our methods of work. And certainly this one has a lot of connections with the first works that we produced in the office, works that were connected with other materials, like, for example, stone. And this is Santiago de Compostela in the north of Spain, where we developed some of these initial works. And stone was a given. We had to work with the stone because this was a historic city, and we had to work with it. So our initial impulse was at the time, didn't know anything about stone, so we said, okay, let's go to the origin. I mean, let's go to those landscapes where stone is extracted, and let's see at how it is done, because only by understanding this, we are going to be able to take the material and work with it in with the intensity, you know, that we like. So, and actually these are videos that I think is the first time that we show them in a lecture. These were recorded with these old cameras that we had at the time in 2006, where we were just looking, you know, looking at how stone is extracted, at the landscapes that this extraction creates.
So these first impulses, approaches to matter, to nature, through an industry, in this case, the quarries, is part of our deep memory. And when we looked recently preparing this lecture, these old movies, we realized that there's something in all this extreme machinery, this kind of subliming the engineering of it, no? The risk, these moments of action, no? Like this explosion that occurred in to get our material, no? We realized that all this was embedded into our interpretation of landscape.
Yeah, and when we visited the quarries and we saw all the material that was there already extracted, after visiting that, we were just unable to use standard products that we could find in a catalog from the industry. We just wanted to reinterpret that landscape and work with it and bring it to the historic center, but with a reinterpretation. And that's what we did. We started without telling the quarry people. We just started working with all the spare material that we had seen, all the irregular stones that are typically discarded and crushed. We just tried to work with models, and this is also a very, we love those documents of the models that we used to produce the wall, in this case was a structural wall, because they also talk a lot about the way in which we have worked after these moments, no? So we produced these models, and then when we knew what we wanted to do, we went back to the quarry and we talked to the quarry owner and we said, okay, we want to use this spare material and we want to do some mock-ups. We need to test how these big stones can get in balance, and we need to get familiar with the tools. We did not have the courage to bring these huge stones to the site in an historic center without being a little bit comfortable. And our hidden plans actually were to build a whole wall in the quarry, but you know, we started little by little getting all the quarry people excited, until eventually we built the whole wall in the quarry. And this was quite beautiful to build it there, because of course, by the time we completed it, we were completely trained and ready to build it on the site. But also it was very interesting to see all that matter that belonged to the site reorganized in a different way.
And we were obsessed by bringing nature, the landscape, into the city, in this case, to the historical city. But all the region was always embedded into the guts, into the matter, into the I would say the terrain, the domain of nature. So we always loved this model, this part of a building that was there, where we would love it to remain, but unfortunately we had to dismantle it and take it back to the city. So this transfer from landscape to architecture, to the urban, back and forth, has been conflicting our practice since the beginning.
And then something that was very interesting about building the wall in the quarry, and also something that pushed us to do it, was that we had no way to engineer this stone wall just with models, because we were working with materials that were in the quarry that we had to select from the site. At the time, we didn't have the tools really to start scanning the stones and selecting them previously. Maybe today we would have done it otherwise, but we took that choice of building it on the on the site, on the quarry, on the original site, and testing it. So, and the testing and the structural calculation was done actually afterwards, and was also very empirical in a way. But it worked, and then we were able to do some numbers, disassemble it, you know, create some kind of marks that would help us recognize all the stones and put them back to place, and take it to Santiago, already selected and perfectly decided where their place was going to be. No? And this would have not been possible without having worked for 4 months that we spent in that quarry with the people that really had the knowledge of working with stone. So this image is actually very important because this is the happy end, but the beginnings were really, really tough. I mean, of course, these are people that know how to cut stone, that have been doing it for many years. And, sometimes they don't like people coming with new ideas, especially if they involve some kind of risks. And this was certainly a risky business in many ways, no? But the good thing is that we were able to, start a negotiation with them and also a learning process and an exchange of knowledge.
And this transfer from landscape to the city to architecture, no, trying to build a wall that even we were trying to make that wall beat according to Vitruvian proportions, no, and this kind of double order palladium. I remember it was in our early drawings, no? Because we thought that a building required of that history of architecture, that presence, that precedent. No? But we still were intrigued and young and unconscious enough to reinvent these conglomerates of mass and to put all these, let's say, gravitas in place.
And we like to compare these two images because this is the built work and this is one of the first models that we did without really knowing what stones we were going to use and how was it going to. And they are completely different, actually. And this is something that has continued in our work and certainly in the work that we will be mainly presenting today, which is the structures of landscape, is something that you will see, you know, where the process of doing things, the engineering embedded in all the actions is the key thing. And the result can be many things. No? What we were looking for was working with a material, working with it in a very structural way, some of the qualities of the space and the light conditions that we were able to bring here. But the final form was not something that we were really concerned about. So, you know, being able to work with those uncertainties and with that flexibility so that you are able to adapt to the tools you have in the moment, to the material itself, to the conditions, it has been very important for us.
So, I think these early works drove us into something that is very relevant to practice architecture, is the ability to kind of surf in a certain uncertainty and trust those consequences as a very creative moment. No? Of course, it has a certain risk that you have to assume and you have to moderate, and that's always compensated by engineering, by care, by craft. But there's also risks that the creative process doesn't correspond exactly with what you previously drew. Generally it's better, but there's a gap between what you think and what you get. No? So I think this extremely active current is very important to understand our interpretation of landscape and also how that matches with our creative process. in this other little project, the truffle, we operated in parallel with this project in a completely different tectonics, but also with a lot of with the same rules in how to create the architecture. No? But we were closer to nature. In this case, a beautiful cliff in the Atlantic coast, where we wanted to deal just with the existing matter, the hay bales, the soil, and the conglomerate of concrete within. So all these encounters, all these matches were for us successful in a material point of view and were a surprise in a formal and spatial point of view. And we actually like this kind of surprise given by how we build things, no? Without getting all the control over it and enjoying all those moments of discovery, of almost archaeology, finding the result of all the work that you've done. No? So all these kind of consequences of the creative process melted with the construction process, almost doing and designing the buildings at the same time, because we have rehearsed and practiced the script, but not because we have prescripted it in a precise and clear document, was what gave us a certain confidence that we could start working with landscape.
So I think that Peter and Kathy Halsted, our clients, in the project in Montana, Tippett Rice Art Center, that we completed recently, I think they saw these initial works, and that's what mysteriously drove them to us. And they, for many years, they had been wanting to build an art center, and they were looking for a landscape to build this art center in connection with landscape, and they fell in love with Montana, which it's we found also recently an amazing landscape and an amazing place, no? Where really you find very sublime and extreme and wild, a wilderness that the client was very interested in, no? So after looking at some of our works, they called us and they wanted us to join them in the adventure of thinking what kind of architecture could be compatible with this site, and how could architecture bring a program, an art program, into this place without entering in conflict with the nature and the values that had attracted them to this very amazing landscape. So we went to the site and we tried to discover it, and it took us many, many days to visit it and to go around it, because this is 11,000 acres, so this is about almost 6,000 hectares, and a place with very few references. For us, it reminded us of a lunar landscape, where it was very difficult to navigate because you didn't have, I mean, in the site where we are working, there are almost no trees except in the perimeter. And it's just, you know, endless landscape of rolling hills. So our proposal had to do with creating a constellation more than creating one building, spreading, fragmenting the building into rooms, into spaces that could be located in different parts of this landscape and that would react with this landscape and would be developing according to this landscape. No? So these would encourage people that commit to, you know, going to this remote place. We thought would be people that wanted to have this very direct contact with the landscape. So this catalog of possibilities that we developed for the client, where these rooms where the art program could be developed and that would also help people navigate the site.
So, departing from this wilderness, this silent, completely absent and lonely and beautiful place, we decided, or we kind of needed, to get rid of architecture, to depart from a very pre-architectonical condition, and try to operate with this no rules, with this no architecture, no typology, no history, no everything that we had before that was guiding us, and it's almost a plinth where you could have a stable perspective of the world. Here, we were completely nude. And we thought that this was going to be a fantastic way to restart. We were not trying to reinvent architecture, we were just trying to get freedom without considering architecture as our source or our motif. So we disposed all these scattered pieces as almost meteorites or fragments of this earth in the different places, and we proposed to Peter and Kathy some examples. For example, the first one was very provocative, but it was the only way to start. We called it the Academia, and it was, explosive, literally, experience where we wanted to celebrate the transformation from mass to space, no? From how to use the energy to provoke a space. So what we did was just a casted matter that required a certain energy, in this case dynamite, to break it into pieces, and the resultant space was going to be inhabited and occupied. So this was the first model that we presented to our client, that we're going to do mining engineering with dynamite explosives to first of all reconfigure the terrain, and after to provoke the transformation, the celebration from energy to space. Something that the physicians are now trying to demonstrate, that we wanted to somehow express as the driver of our project.
So these are some of this is how we started designing, and this is how we started thinking back in the office. We tried to find the materials, the tools that would serve us to think about the site without the site, and imagine these architectures that could almost be born from it, and also learning from geological processes. So we were thinking about how to create a space through explosion, like here, sedimentation, erosion, fragmentation, and through that we were developing different types of spaces. So the Academia that we were seeing is a space for gathering, for conversation, for where artists can get together and discuss, or where an artist can present a project, or also where an artist can develop an artwork through that architecture. And you've seen we developed about like 30 different pieces. We are going to show you some of them, not all, but they all have a different nature that respond to the site. This other one that we call the Ponte is a space that happens in a canyon, in between two elevated spots, in a way inhabiting that canyon, but also providing a connection in a place where it would benefit the itinerary of the people and would connect to otherwise disconnected places. No, so here, to develop the Ponte, we were creating the print in the ground where we would be casting this structure, and we were in a way rehearsing how this process could be done, how we'd be getting that excavation that would actually serve afterwards as the space to climb the hill, how would we reinforce and insert structure into that hole in the ground, and how we would after displace that mass to serve as the bridge, but leaving the print that had created it, no? And how that would turn to be also a place to be occupied, no? And to enjoy the site.
La Fontana is another place. It's a fountain, but a fountain in a non-urban spot. So we wanted somehow to collect and filter some of the naturally collected in ponds or in small reservoirs, but celebrate this architectonically with this leaking almost shell that had covered a space and could also be experienced by all those leaks as a fantastic shower under that very, very aggressive heat in the summer, like a refreshing bath or shower, not only for the visitors, but also for the animals, So we designed this kind of vase of wrinkled, corrugated concrete, almost petreous or magmatic material, with a structure that could unbalance. So when all this water was filled, this structure lost its balance and transformed into a waterfall and threw all that water away. And all this metaphor about water, the liquidity of concrete, the magmatic condition of this stone, was also part of that process where we added the pressure of weight into the hydrostatic system of the casting moment when the concrete is still liquid, and used this as a driving creative force. And this also had to be finally re-engineered to maintain a certain balance with the enormous weight of water until the moment that this, like in an Etruscan bath, flows from pond to pond and creates that kind of precipitation of the cascade of water over the pond. So all these actions of nature were what we were working with, and the formal aspects of those were something that we were not we were not preoccupied with. This is we call it the midnight rostra, not rostra as the face, and midnight because it faces a beautiful canyon that is in the boundaries of the property, and we wanted also to use that same oblique casting of the concrete that almost flow like a river when it goes speedy, steeped under a hill, and that creates a different conglomeration of the concrete. So this was going to be the engineering process. And the containing of this as an emergency action, and the action of erecting, of lifting that structure that has all its balance in the upper part, is part of the engineering and the metaphor of this tongue of matter that salutes or looks to that canyon.
So with these projects that what you are seeing now are the very early documents that we produced, almost suggesting those episodes in the landscape that we were envisioning, and that would relate and would interpret the different moments that we saw in that landscape in very different ways, but that, being different in their form, they all had a discourse or an identity that linked, so that people would recognize each of these structures in the site and would help them to, or would invite them to navigate through the whole site, and would also, in a way, present a moment of stop, moment of activity in this itinerary and all the miles, that people need to circulate in order to visit the whole site.
For example, this project, La Reticula, were 10 patio houses. We created this kind of unitarian figure that faced all these courtyards and were all tilted over a valley. So the way we
match the creative process with the idea of floatability of these bubbles of space within the reticula instead of governing the geometry. We somehow broke the idea of the geometry as a fixed law and let all those bubbles of air, of space, floatate among that reticula, and therefore reinstall their own, let's say, position within that microconstellation that the previous reticula created. So all these aspects of freedom and of uncertainty were really, really important to arrive to the conclusion of this language and these spaces. And finally, la tabula acustica. This is the biggest piece, the most architectural one that hopefully we will start building it soon. It's in the upper part of the plot. Well, the plot, the ranch, and it operates like a Greek temple. No, it culminates the interpretation of this landscape. It's also an acoustical shell, no? Where we wanted to visually and almost spiritually bring the Bertuth and the Yellowstone Rocky Mountains into the spatiality of that shelter.
This is further developed. This is a little bit more developed than the other ones. So in the concept stage, what we did was building these models, then scanning them and reinterpreting them, and also working with the scale, because one of the most challenging things working in this site was to really find the good scale for these structures. We are competing with an amazingly vast landscape, and that was a difficult moment. So here we are taking this to a next stage, and we are developing this structure and also thinking already more deeply about the engineering and how we are going to build it. No? And the way we are going to build it is we have these three cores that contain some of the stairs, elevator, and also some of the supporting spaces. And then we are carving the ground, the rock, we are casting these acoustic shell, and which is also the slab on top, and then we are lifting it with some hydraulic systems.
So this inversion of the mountains as a space that brings that horizon into the intimate, almost very, very tactile condition of that concrete has to work as an auditorium. It has to shelter acoustically 1,000 people. But we wanted still to draw those mountains and cast them and make the action of that elevation, no? The moment of almost the destiny of all this project. This is kind of an homage to the Rocky Mountains, no? And this slab that weighs 6,000 tons will be carried and jacked hydraulically through the guide of these three columns. One that is the petrification of almost a magmatic tree that occupies the central position, and two tangentially that also operate as materializations of the trees, the grasses, and all the matter that is surrounding the place.
So these and the three that we will show next, that are the ones that we have already built, and others we are the ones that we presented to the client, and we said, okay, you asked for an art center, this is our vision, and this is what we would like to to build. Of course, you can see it's a very open scheme. I mean, it was clear that the client could be building one of them, two, three, 10, 15. It can be done over time. What was driving us was this idea of creating an identity in the architecture that would help people recognize where there was an infrastructure of water, a place to connect, a place to develop an activity, a place to meet, a place to listen to music, because this art center is focused mainly on outdoor sculpture, but is also very much focused in music and how music interacts with these architectures and with the landscape. And so also it was very important that these architectures require very little maintenance. This is in Montana at the edge of the Yellowstone Park. I think it's quite a challenging and ambitious program that, you know, at that time we didn't know how successful it wanted to be. So these architectures cannot look empty. They could not require a lot of maintenance because they are spread so far away from one each other. No? So part of the idea was, how can these architectures really embed in the landscape and be part of it, no matter if they are being used or not? And how, you know, where is the point where it also starts becoming part of the art program, or it serves as architecture and therefore has a function and a use. So now we're going to talk about the three of them that we have built, that the client with us selected, which are Vertud Porta, Inverted Porta, which are kind of windows into the landscape, and then Domo, which is a larger piece that also has an acoustical serves as an acoustical shell for concerts.
So these two portals are the entrances, huh? the places that introduces the visitor and the place to its function, and that relates the constellation. So this piece is called the Vertud Portal because there's an amazing geological formation just in the middle of the mountain. Is called the Vertud formation, where the two plaques, the continental and the Pacific plaques, collide and merge like teeth. No, so we were working in that. Action, no? that action of collision that we thought could be made experientially as an architecture artifact. No? Typologically, we put together these two solids in a, we could call it an arch if we want to make it like Romanesque or typological, but basically it's a very primarial moment of balance, of equilibrium. No? As you can see in these sketches, all this was, of course, fully engineered. We knew until the last kilo of stress where it was going, but that's the second part of the engineering. But the first moment was a more, let's say, mathematic or sculptural action.
Yeah, so you can see here the process where the drawings are already suggesting how this is going to be built. And so for these portals, the best way to build it was to cast them flat and then wait until the 28 days until the concrete had cured and then lift them. So we carved, you know, this, of course, we are learning from the truffle, the project that we have done previously. We were carving on the ground the form that, as you can see, was not really super important, you know, that it was precise. We were also taking decisions on the moment, and then we were reinforcing the ground, putting the concrete, and then tilting it in its position.
And that this maneuver that wanted to be poetically like very, very elemental and primarial, it's a very, very complex engineering problem. No? I mean, just by
the challenge of calculating the center of gravity of these 300 tons stones was important, no? Because there's always there's a certain freedom into these geometries that are very, very, very complex. No? So this way of doing architecture has a very raw beginning, even intellectual and site-specific, almost feeling about the site. No? And it has a very, very precise need of engineering, because there's no way that we could have a minor, let's say, error in the movement, in the placement of these pieces. This could have been catastrophic if it happened. So the difference of the total freedom, the total uncertainty, and the total need of precision and engineering was the let's say the beauty of working with the landscape.
And you can see now the recipe that we had elaborated, no, of how things were going to happen. Suddenly they are happening on the site, no, and they seem to happen like naturally, but the fact is that as it happened in the quarry, you know, there was a very important moment of getting everybody on board. When we were in the lab, in the office, we were by ourselves imagining, having fun, okay, let's explode this, let's cast this here, let's tilt it up, but then there's a moment when, you know, you have a client that you have to describe this and really get them to believe in what you are believing. And when you're doing things that are not conventional, this is a major thing. And then there's a moment where, you know, you cannot be building this by yourself. No, you have to be working with the local people, the local engineers, the construction companies. And they have to believe in it. I mean, they have to be doing it. And it's a beautiful moment because it happens like a choreography. And of course, here we were part of the construction process as we were in Santiago or in the Truffle. But in the Truffle, it was just us. And here we were doing this with a lot of other people involved. No? And there was a moment of exchanging knowledge, and there was a moment of involvement where also the project was evolving, you know, with the input of other experts.
As you can see here, the concrete is mixed in an improper way. No? I mean, as you know, the concrete has to be very well mixed, taken care of, and when everything is ready, the mold, the temperature, all the different moments of that recipe has to be fully coordinated. If you break that coordination, it's amazing, no? Because you get all the, let's say, impure and materiality, all the different textures, the mixture of the pigments is irregular, so you get extraordinary petros tints and materialities, no? So we wanted to explore this dual condition of concrete as a very, very artificial construct. A wrinkled, almost terrain map in the outside, and almost viscous, terrose interior that faced that perspective of the canyon. No? So all these differences of the portal was the one that created the I would say the material identity. Material identity, that when we did the inverted portal is the other entry, because the ranch has like two paths that connect through a loop. We wanted to connect these two entries with the same, let's say, motif, but in a complete different space condition. So the inverted portal, instead of tilting and encountering in the top, they slided and they touched. And they offered to the interior part that smooth, shiny surface, and expressed that abrasive, terrace, materic surface to the exterior. And even though the pieces have approximately the same, let's say, scale and weight, 50 tons plus or minus between one and two each other, but the composition, the equilibrium, differs substantially. The engineering process was pretty much the same, was the interpretation through 3D scan photogrammetry and engineering all that in a system that put together all that complex geometries with the requirement of reinforcement and the maneuver. No? These maneuvers were, as we said, strictly coordinated into a very, very precise script because any rotation of that mass, because the jacks were not pulled in the proper way, was going to be very, very dangerous.
So now we are on the site, we are removing that soil, and we are creating the molds for the structures to be casted, as we were doing also with Bertrand Porto.
It was very, very exciting to quantify and to, let's say, print a certain geometry and GPS data to all those thicknesses and let's say layers that were going to be encountered with the terrain, no? Terrain that we removed, compacted, reclaimed. No? So all that usage of the landscape as canvas, as vase, and as, I would say, frame. No? Was continuous in all these projects. The plastics, the pigments were used, as I said before, with all the freedom and all the, let's say, the deployment of the circumstances, and without considering other constructability than the necessity to keep all the concrete together, and. The result was just the print of that moment. No? The pigmentation was a mixture between artificial and natural soils, and was done not through the mix, but almost like an action painting, no? Throwing it with a different criteria that if it was ready mixed, like all the concretes.
Yeah, and even though the project had been designed, engineered, we had done some mock-ups, you know, this, it's an architecture where there is a moment of discovery. I mean, there's a moment of uncertainty where we have casted something, but we are not really sure of how it's going to come until we take that plastic away and we really see the final effect.
And that is really something very, very attractive architectonically, no? Because when you do a, let's say, a normal building, you do it like little by little. This is like a shot, no? It's if you fail the shot, you're done. So it's pretty exciting. I totally recommend it. By the way, the clients don't like it because they want to see how things are going on. So I mean, this took months. And when our client were asking us for a report, we said, no, everything's okay. I mean, we couldn't say nothing else. No? We knew that we had everything under control, but we could not demonstrate it because everything was covered, was hidden, was unearthed yet.
So Domo is the third and the last of the structures that we have built. It's a space that recreates the space. If Tabula was recreated the space of the mountains, Domo recreates the space of the hills and is located on top of two of the hills. And it creates this kind of a space where it seems it has been almost extracted from it. And these were the initial models, the scanning of the model that we did. the plants that were generated from the cuts into that model, and that really only serve in this case for some mode of representation, but that really were not the tools by which we were really designing or engineering them.
I mean, this vaulted space, not the domo. Domo is a word in between a dome, a house, a shelter, a cavern. And this kind of ambiguity was the one, the kind of quality or atmosphere that we wanted to give to this piece. No, it comes semantically and materially by the action of casting a hill system that was voided as an inversion into the terrain, and offers all that smoothness to a continuous cavernous space.
In this case, due to the scale of the structure, is not something that we could move. So the process of construction in this case was different. It had to do with recreating that form of the space, and then casting on top of it, and then removing the ground to discover the space.
And the way that we designed it was, again, building a model. This model was built, because it was big, in the same plot where the truffle is. It's not in the plain, it's right there. So we had a kind of an emotional need to go to this place where all our position and vision about landscape came, and to somehow make this offer, no? And work there, work in this case in a different landscape, but still a landscape. No? So we did all this molded hill system, and we unearthed it, discovering again the hills that after we went to Montana and provided that let's say variables of reality. No?
Yeah, so you can see that the process of design and the process of modeling and the process of it's a process of training almost, where we are changing a scale from one to another, and then getting skilled so that when we arrive to the site, and this is now the site of Domo, we are ready for construction, and we don't know what the final absolute textures are going to be, but we have done the mock-ups. We know they're going to be amazing, even though no, we are not absolutely 100%. We cannot give an image of the final outcome, no? And it's not important. The important part is to control this moment that we have started with the models, the small models, then you know, practiced and trained ourselves in the larger scale with already working with earth and soil and some mock-ups on the site with the real materials, and then we go and we perform, no, like the final performance on the site with everybody confident that they know their role in this.
So this of uncontrolled excavation, no? That was resembling the geometries that we had previously engineered, but only those reinforcements, only the tensions were precise according to this engineering. The mold had a big, let's say, uncertain leverage. And these moments of placing the plastics, wrinkling them, pigmenting the surfaces, and how that concrete was going to push in one side or another, was the actions that really were crucial in the final cash. So this indefinition of the stiffness of the mold, the moment of casting, was what made this moment, no, the unearthing, almost an archaeological discovery. No? And after needed, with little tools, a lot of care and repair and unwrapping, no? Until we could discover all the structure.
So we call them structures of landscape because they are born from this landscape. They are casted in it. They are extracted from it. And they mediate between the vastness of the place and the scale of the person. So they help in a way to find a shelter in this wild landscape that you see here in the images, you know, in a very partial way, because you have to be there to feel the wind, to feel the extreme sun, to feel the snow, and to really realize that they do operate as architectural pieces. Of course, they serve as, you know, they also are part of the art program, and they can operate as objects against the landscape, and they are okay if they are empty. But they do have architectural qualities that have to do with providing shade where there is none, with regulating the temperatures. So when it's very hot, the massiveness of these rocks provide and cool the space inside. They shelter from the snow, from the wind. The shiny and reflective surfaces make the sound travel when there's a performance or there's an artist rehearsing. And they themselves become instruments where the sound travels. No? And of course, you have to be there to realize these other properties that are embedded in the structures and that are waiting there to be completed by the people that will visit them.
And I think this is how finally we could arrive to architecture, no? By adding life and a program and letting people inhabit this structure, in this case as acoustical shells.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anton and Deborah. That was incredible. It was so fascinating to learn more about, I guess, how you can actually build something that massive in the landscape. Brett had to go take a call, so I'm just going to try and take a couple of questions from the audience. I just thought to start things off, I wanted to ask, what did you think about in terms of the lifespan of these projects? I think sometimes when you see images of them in the landscape, it made me think that hundreds of years from now, if people came across them, it could be like Stonehenge, where we wonder who put those stones in place. And I was just wondering if that was some part of the process that you encountered while preparing for them.
Well, part of the process is the fact that they will keep changing, and they have already changed since we built them. So the fact that they are built mixing soil with concrete, it's also to create absorbent surfaces for acoustic reasons in some moments, is also to allow for nature to take over. You know, so we are relinquishing control, and actually the wind has already blown seeds from the grasses, and there are already some plants growing on those textures. So that was also part of the idea of this project, that, as I was saying before, they can exist without the need of a program by themselves, and they don't create this need for an architecture that has to be maintained and that has to be filled in a specific way or used in a specific way, no?
But you're right. I mean, they will remain there for a long time. Eh? First of all, because they could resist a thermonuclear war, I think. And because they are conceived as timeless and natural parts of the landscape, no? So I cannot imagine no one removing them, eh? Because I think that doesn't exist the machine that could transport that. But they are conceptually part of that place, no? So they were born and they will stay.
And also something very interesting that we noticed, this is grazing land, so it's a land that needs to be grazed, it needs for cows and sheep to be there, and that was also part of the mission, no? How to bring the art program but let it coexist with the ranching activity that is already existing in the place, no? And the animals love these architectures, no? And they actually use it as shelter, and during the construction we already saw, when it was snowing, how the animals found their shelter in these structures, no? Because it's suddenly a moment of protection in a very open place. So if people don't use it, I'm sure somebody else will.
Sorry, I just have one more question. Is the plan still to build the whole collection, or are you phasing it over?
It is our plan.
Yeah, anything could happen. I mean, I think that now the opening was in June, and it opened with these structures with very amazing sculptures by Mark Ditsubero, Patrick Doherty, Calder. I mean, a very very good art program, very good music program also happening, and it just started. So I guess that the center will also evolve as the program does.
We actually were discussing this morning, no? Because we want to develop the technique, the language, the architecture, no? Of it. And three pieces, like two doors and a room, it's okay. We love it. But we think that by the inclusion of different scales and programs like the infrastructure part, like the biggest tabula acustica, the room, no, that has a completely different architectonical scale, we didn't show all of them, but there's bathrooms, it's like if a building had imploded into pieces, no? So to make this architectonically coherent in its scattered position, we require, different parts of that constellation to happen, and to complete the project.
Any questions from the audience?
Hi. For me, probably very exciting part about this whole, all these projects is, you know, the degree of the control of the whole process. And so for me, there's a question be, what is, you know, the point where you say, you know, okay, you know, this is not pouring the way it should be pouring, or, you know, this is where, you know, this should stop. So what's the degree to which you control, you know, have there ever been a point where you'd be like, oh no, you know, that poured wrong?
There's no way you can arrive to that point, okay? So what we say, I mean, you have to distinguish between uncertainty and discontrol, okay? And the difficulty is to have a lot of uncertainty and total control. Total control is that you have to know what you do.
And the certainty is that the consequences of what you know that we're doing are unexpected, okay? So you know that the concrete has to be put here and not here, okay? But you also know, that's why you are under control, that by the action of the pour of that concrete in this distance with this mix, this will create a surface that has an uncertain, let's say, appearance or form, okay? But you are under control. The result is uncertain. This is the difference. Generally, bad architecture, the result is certain, and you are totally without control, okay? But the result is very certain. You know it before the building is going to be built, okay? And this is a bad job, but it's a good way to correspond this.
Right? Yeah, I mean, the challenge here is that we couldn't give the client, you know, like the final image of what they were going to get, because there was no final image. There were a lot of, when we say a lot of decisions that were taken, you know, there were some technical decisions that were taken in the process, trying to optimize and improve the methods of construction, but it's not that we were changing the structural scheme during the construction or basic architectural aspects that for us are not that final form. We were not concerned whether the tint would go in one direction or in another direction, or whether the wrinkle of the plastic would do this effect or this other. We were controlling the form, we were controlling the materiality, we were controlling the density of wrinkles in order to provide a certain acoustic space, but it was not like the final position of all these elements that we were concerned. So some clients would be very concerned if they don't get like a final image of how, what is this going to look. Of course, we had the perfect ally. I mean, this would have not been possible without the client that we had. But of course, it was a client that when it came to us, they said, I mean, we don't want a building. We want something that will really connect people with the landscape. And we don't want a facade, and we don't want a finished product. So this was a partnership, a perfect partnership with a client that was supporting us in that freedom, in that imagination, but then was trusting that we would be in control of what we were doing.
This kind of follows on from that question a bit, and it's a nerdy question about how it happens. I can understand the need for the domo to have the ground recomposed before you excavate and fill it in. But when you made the model for it near the truffle, you just dug into the ground, and the ground's full with all these unknowns, huge rocks, roots, springs. But when you made the porter, it appeared you also recomposed the ground or imported new ground before you did the excavation. And I think there's an important distinction between using that existing ground layer and then rebuilding it. And I wondered why, technically, it was necessary to recompose the ground.
Well, yeah, that's a good question. And those are the circumstances that you have to face. The fact is that we had the bedrock immediately below. And that was a good reason to use that as a stable field. And so it was kind of part of the terrain dug under, the other part supported by part of the gravel that has added to do the roads. And the second question was that we don't want to touch, to harm very much the vegetable layer, okay? So we only touch those bedrock moments where there was a physical touch of the structure, let's say the footing, the foundational part, and the rest we wanted to protect. So when we retire all that added terrain, sand, gravel, it was almost untouched. So again, nature rapidly would have been reclaimed and taken reposition of that.
Yeah, so these are part of the adaptations that we were doing also based on the conversation. So for example, the rancher who manages all that I mean, all the grace, all the land that the sheep and the cow eat from. He was concerned also about, you know, creating a big print, in especially in those places where the activity, the ranching activity happens. So we were thinking, how can we then produce these structures, but then, you know, not affect more than the print that they have, no? So that was part of these conversations. And also where we were trying to get very reflective surfaces to reflect sound or to reflect the lights of the sky and the background of the mountains, you know, we did not really care about the form or the rocks from the ground. Where we were creating the rough surfaces, yes, we were mixing with the local soils and stones and grasses.
That also explains, I guess, where the foundations were with my other question. So the bedrock is very, very close, and you just go through the soil a small way and connect to it. That's great. Thank you.
Any other questions?
I'm just wondering, looking at your projects, not just this one, but the previous one also, some of your buildings, they are equally impressive, not just in terms of architecture, but also the engineering aspects of it. And it almost looks like it's always been an important part of your projects. So my question is whether you have a close collaborators, engineers that you always work with and understand your aim and share the same excitement about the type of project you're doing.
That's a very important one. I mean, all these moments of art or creativity are supported by engineering, supported by craft, supported by material knowledge, okay? If you don't have these experiences, these aptitudes, you cannot do it, okay? I mean, so it's very important. It's the most important thing. To know what you're doing. And said that, we were the builders of both of three of these projects. We were the contractors. As you can see, Deborah, almost an infant, taking care of construction. I had the black hair myself. and dealing with, I remember she lived for 6 months in the quarry. That's terrible, you know. But was the only way to individually pick each of those rocks, select them, position them. We didn't have 1-2-3 catch or 3D scans by then, so we had to sketch rapidly by hand, almost like a 3D model. And engineer almost instantly where that center of gravity was located. So when we pulled from the chain, it didn't move. So the position that we had estimated could artistically occur in that wall was previously engineered. I mean, you cannot play with when you lift 30 tons. You lift 30 tons, is the position of the center of gravity and where are you deploying the forces, the way the rock will move. Once the rock is this, that's the place you are putting it. You cannot like twist it, you know? So all that is pure engineering. And yes, we do have an engineer, Jesus. His name is Jesus. That comes to the office every week. And we talk. We work, he protects us. But when we built the wall in the quarry without his permission, I remember going with Jesus to the quarry and say, well, what do you think? So, looks fine, you know. And so we tested the engineering wall. We got the same machines and hit the wall like brutally, and well, the walls stand pretty good. And after we did the engineering, so it was done in reverse. In that case, in the structures of a landscape, no, it was fully engineered.
Recently, we got awarded, that was funny, by the National Engineering US Award. But they created a category, special projects, no? Because they didn't know if this was commercial, residential, high-rise, low-rise, mid-rise. So this is an exercise of engineering, I would say. The artistic, the aesthetic proposition, the linguistic is just the result, right? But all we do is always considering the importance of the technique.
Yeah, I think that especially the projects that we have shown where we are very involved in the design, in the construction, I mean, and almost the construction of the construction becomes an extension of the construction of the models. No, of course, we are finding our own allies. No, where and those are from the client to the engineer to the contractor. I mean, we are talking from the contract to the contractor while we are doing the design. Because if not, you know, we cannot just develop the design and then go and say, okay, build this, no? Because it's a negotiation. It's like, it's a moment of seduction, no? You have to, when you want to change the rules, you have to bring people and engage people and involve people in the discussion so that they own the project also in a way. That's why Santon was saying, I had to move to the quarry, no? I had to be there every day because I could not arrive there with a plan and say, okay, build this and go away, no? And leave them with the adventure, no? We had to build that moment of trust, of relation, of, okay, you're working here, you know, you are, you know, moving these huge stones and, you know, creating some very delicate moments, and I'm going to be here. And we are going to be making decisions with you as we build.
But also there's very important parts of this is when you add the business terms into the conversation. I remember when we went to the owner of the quarry, and we pointed out all that wasted material that he had all the way, all everywhere, no? And we told him, okay, if we got all this material away, how much would you pay us? You know? And he said, oh, whatever you want. I mean, it's for me, I don't know what to do with all these kind of rocks that are ugly because they have like different strange faces. There's no way I can put them into the, you know, to the industrial process correctly. So for me, it's just waste. Okay, no, that wasn't the business deal, ultimately. But breaking the rules, the engineering, the economics, I mean, all the factors of the reality are very important, no? Working with the people in Montana has been an extraordinary experience, but we didn't know how important is, for example, the weather when you're in Montana. And when you are in civilized London or Madrid or Boston, the weather, well, it's important, but you know, it's under control. Over there, it's brutal. No? So the weather is what tells you if you are going to work or not, if you're going to crane or not. The weather dictates what you're going to do. We didn't know that until we arrived there. And we woke up one day and it was 25 degrees below zero and we had 2 feet of snow. So where did this come from, you know? And so, I mean, engineering, the daily circumstances of the site work, the people, the team, you know, all these aspects are, I would say, much more important than the design. You know, the design is kind of the spark. I would say the same. It's like an instant of creativity and a long life of hard work, you know? But the creativity is, yeah, it, of course, it's very important. It detonates everything, it starts everything, but it's a very little moment. Yeah? This project, I mean, I feel a little bit embarrassed to say it, but it took us 3 years, yeah? to put four stones together. I mean, the efficiency of the productivity is no good, but believe me, we were full-time committed to it. Yeah? And we did like 35 works on it. We were on site. We were frozen. When we conceived it, was an instant almost. Right? We didn't know what we were doing. We said, okay, well, boom, okay.
And after kind of 3 years of hard work, engineering, construction, I mean, that's architecture. Right?
Yeah, and also knowing where you can build this, no? Because in Montana, we were able to build it because of the client and the circumstances, the legal frameworks, and but in other contexts, it would be stupid to propose this. No? So also, you have to be aware of all the dimensions, no? And actually, we're very happy that we were able to build it, because if not, we feel that it would be one of these projects that people would look at and would say, okay, yeah, I'm sure you can build it, no, yeah. But so there's a critical point where you really need to build it, because if not, it will be, you know, like a very nice idea that you once had and that nobody believes in.
I have a question. Stone and with concrete, which I think are two very different materials, and as you show, like two very different processes of constructions. So I was just curious if you have ever considered or are considering another material, and what would that be, if it would be equally heavy or maybe a lighter one? I don't know.
No, I like this question, because when we first showed the projects of stone, and we just had buildings with the stone, like, people asked us, why do you love stone so much? No, and we love it. No, and then when we show the concrete works, people tell, why do you love concrete so much? No, and the fact is that we have built with a wide range of materials, but we love all them so much. Like, when we work with the stone, we want to work to the quarry, we want to understand. We don't want to confine the material into a rectangular slab, 30 centimeters by 30 centimeters, and no, I mean, we feel that that's not the destiny of that poor stone, no? So that's, no, maybe this is our way of thinking. So when we have worked with precast concrete, we went to the factory, and we went there, and we saw what was being produced, and we took it from there, no? When we've worked with concrete, yeah, with precast, but then liquid concrete, we work, you know, in exploring other possibilities, and now we are actually working with ultralight structures using foam, using cold formed steel profiles that are also very light, with completely an opposite outcome. And people think if we are schizophrenic or something, or if Antoni is doing the one part of the works and I'm doing the other ones or something, because the result is absolutely different, and this is because the projects that we produce respond very, in a very strong way with the technologies that correspond to those materials, or that we feel that are appropriate for those materials.
But you have to think that most of the construction materials are based in stones. A glass is a stone. A metal profile is a stone. Right? It comes a mineral that is melted and then laminated. Even the plastics, if you think about it, are stones pretty deep that you take them out, process them. I mean, maybe the woods is another family. Right? I think that we don't care about materials. Or we love them as matter, and we don't care about the massive properties of materials either. Yeah? We discovered this very recently. What we do care is about the physic reaction that any matter has with the gravity and becomes like a force. No, the force as a let's say the main spatial detonator, no? When something is lifted or forced up or tilted, or I mean, when there's something anti-gravitatorial, there's a reaction that, well, we call it space, right? I mean, we do think that by putting all those these two moments, that there's a space, right? There's a connection. This is just because there's reaction against
against a force reaction against gravity, and that's architecture. Okay, if this becomes from a very massive material like concrete or granite, as we have shown, it's okay. If this comes from a very, very light material, like we are now experiencing, it's okay. It's the same force. It's just the mass as an internal property of matter that has changed and differed. When you do categorize heavy materials, concrete, stones, well, yeah. I mean, there's ultra-light concrete that weighs a third than a stone, and it's still under the category of heavy. But I think that's mass properties that could be transformed architecturally, but the weight, no, the spatial consequence of that equilibrium, that action, that architectural reaction to weight is what is very, very essential for us. And we express spatial and structural connections by using that weight of all the materials, independently of their mass. I don't know if this is clear enough, but I think that's the architectonic part of it. No? That's why we feel a certain indifference, or we are especially free in terms of working with pre-stressed concrete or with a ultralight foam beam, because the force that we are operating especially is the same.
So would you say that what you're designing is construction processes? Or, I mean, because there are some architects that say that, yes, they look at material and they work with material, but it's never like this. And perhaps it's not so much about material, but about process. Or how is your creative process usually?
Well, I think we have a paranoical, bipolar obsession. One is those projects that come from the landscape, and therefore they're subduing part of their creative process to that origin, like those that we have seen. And we're working in also others that are more synthetic, because they come from an industrial process, no? Like with structures coming from a pre-stress factory, or projects that we are developing now in our lab at MIT. It's called POPLA, prototypes of prefabrication, that do come from the conjunction of different technologies in favor of their lightness. This is what we have been lecturing for years, no? Stones and beams as two symbols of one thing that is given by nature, something that somebody has invented, no? And these have created in our practice two parallel lines that go in parallel, never coincide, but they go in kind of in parallel. And we've built stones in concrete, in stone, natural stone, and in foam. We've been stones in foam and in stones in metal blades. Okay. And we've built beams in pre-stressed concrete. So we've built beams in metal, in steel. So the material flows from family to family, but conceptually, all this set of projects are kind of under a clear unity. Yeah? It's not imposed, it's given.
But the way that we design, it's very much like you have seen here, no? It's we try to absorb as much as possible from the site, what the client wants, the program, and then there's a moment of creativity that happens, typically thinking with our hands, so building, and that's how we, and building collectively, and that's how. You know, we start figuring out and feeling what makes sense, what works, what doesn't work. And it's a process of almost discovery through the model. That's the way that we feel most comfortable, no? And then the drawings happen from analyzing and dissecting those models.
In Ensamble Studio, we always make the joke that in a corporate office, the intern does the models. And the principal does the contracts. No? In Ensemble Studio, we do the models, and somebody will do the contracts. Right? but we do all the models. I mean, and year by year, we're becoming more, we venerate more the model. Sometimes I say, this is it. And the collaborators say, what do you mean? There's like three sticks and turn out, this is it. We just have to follow what the model is telling us. No? And we put all the process in that line. For example, now it's kind of easy because we have a fantastic technology that you can give to someone the Domo model and say, this is it. And somebody will scan it, somebody will engineer, somebody will, you know. On the end, we have to be part of all this, but we do think that the model, and that's why we share with you all this intimacy, that we are doing the models, and the model is not an act of representation. Eh? We've never printed a model. Eh? I mean, I think printing a model is a perversion. And never print a model. Models cannot be printed. You can print something that somebody else could do. Model has to contain all your soul, your substance. You know, it has to be part of everything. And I cannot imagine a model that is printed unless the building is going to be printed. Then it's okay. Eh?
If it's okay, can we take one more question?
Yeah. You know, the questions is the part of the lectures that I like the most.
Hi, thank you for the lecture. And I think it's quite evident from the examples that you showed today that you're interested in this blurred boundary between nature and artificial and art and architecture. But I guess in the context of the city, how do you deal with projects that are not dealing with landscape and this beautiful, you know, nature? How different is it, like your approach? Or how similar it is?
So I would say give us a couple of years, maybe, because that's actually where we are, you know, at the moment, no? But I mean, landscapes can be fabricated, and in the city, cities are many things, and there are many cities, no? And you have all typically history. I mean, the project in Santiago de Compostela is in a city, it's in a historical center, it's in a garden, and it's mediating also between the landscape of where the material comes from and the architecture of that city, which is mainly built with granite. So I wouldn't make a general statement, but I can say that we are very interested in, you know, bringing many of the things that we have learned while making a structures landscape. And, you know, many of the things that we have been liberated from, no? And how free we have been building structures of landscape. And also seeing the reaction of people when they get close to those structures, no? We keep learning from that work because it's a work where we are receiving a lot of feedback also from people that go visit. No? For us, it has been an amazing experience after building it, also, you know, listening to music, you know, with that landscape, etc. So, you know, we are now very interested in how can we fabricate landscapes in the city.
If you think about, this is a very important question because I think landscape is a human aspiration. We live in the cities, and we love the cities because we love to be with others, no? But as soon as we can, we escape, no? That's why the weekend has been invented, no? To get out of the city. Anyway, there's a fact that architecture has been exploring lately how to bring part of that landscape inside. And we've seen very horrendous examples, no? Like gardening facades, or terraces that, you know, I mean,
I think the city has its own set of rules that differ completely. So we are now very invested in how architecturally we could bring landscape, but not plants, okay? Certain rules that come from the landscape into let's call it a city, no? A very abstract system of infrastructure, public spaces, buildings, no? Because it's a fact that the city has been very, very abstracted from everything else, no? The international style that we all adore and love, but was part of that kind of abstract distance to everything else, no? So that's a good question. Of course, the set of rules would be completely different. Yeah? There's no way you can move a crane like the 5 cranes that we had there through New York City, okay? The logic of industry, of fabrication, of putting things together with a completely different set of rules in different heights and scales, that has to be considered, no? And we're actually now working intensively in this, this bringing landscape to the city. And as I said, the project in Santiago was a first example. And the project in Montana is how to bring architecture into landscape without harming it, without imposing it, without throwing a building, no? I mean, throw a building in that hill would have had the same effect as planting a vertical garden in a wall in the middle of the city, no? You like it. But it's not its proper or natural place, no? And this is the difficulty.
Okay, well, I think that's quite an exciting point to end about what could come next. But I just wanted to thank everyone here for coming, and above all, to thank both of you for sharing these incredible projects with us.